looks good. It looks good. Open your Bibles this morning to Old Testament Psalm, probably one you've never heard before, the 23rd Psalm, please. Don't shut me down because you think you know everything about that particular psalm. I hope to bring out some things that perhaps you hadn't thought about yet, but there's just some things that I think are absolutely relevant to where we are in the body of Christ today that come out in the psalm. To be quite honest with you, in the last several months, I found myself working through some things, as we all do, and the Lord and the Holy Spirit just led me to pray this psalm. And as I did, it began to come alive to me in a sense that I'd never seen before. And I hope to share some of that with you this morning. I don't know that I'll labor all the way through all six verses, but we will be heading that direction. And while you're searching that out, Psalm 23, let me just encourage those of you that may have come from a different location today. This isn't where you normally come, perhaps because it's Mother's Day, or perhaps you've heard advertising over SBN or the radio station. You're here this morning. I want to recommend Oasis of Love with all of my heart to you. If you don't have a local church, you need to be in a local church. Now, I appreciate you watching SBN, and I want you to keep on doing that. But the Bible tells us not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, especially as we get closer to the return of the Lord.
Amen.
A couple more amens in that would be good.
Amen.
And you need to be in a house of God where the Spirit of God is moving, where the Word of God is being preached and proclaimed. You need that.
Amen. That's right.
I said, you need that.
Amen.
And I appreciate but you know, the good thing about being in a local assembly is you do things when you walk through those doors that you can't do standing at home watching television.
Yes, that's right.
You start to participate in other people's faith. You start to encourage other people. You influence other people just because you come into the building. And you can't do that over television.
Amen.
We're there as a substitute until you find a good local church. We're not trying to replace the good local church. We're trying to find and found and lay foundation for the body of Christ in good local churches. Now, SBN can reach international, where the Oasis of Love won't be able to do it. But Oasis of Love is reaching people in that condition that we won't be able to do it because of you. And so it's not an either or. It should be both. It should be active in both. And I just pray that if you would allow Brother David and Sister Francis to pastor you, I can guarantee you this: you'll be everything but sorry.
Amen.
Can anybody in the church say amen? And I count them as my friends when I need a couple of days to just sneak away from Baton Rouge. This is where I come first. Because I just love Brother David, and he's my friend. I can count on him. He can counsel me and encourage me. And all the fellows in the church here, Brother Young, Eddie, I had a great time of fellowship yesterday. I talked theology with Francis Allen till the cows come home, if we get the chance, and all the rest of you. I've just come to love you. So this is my home away from home. I'm sneaking out to get a breath of fresh air, then I'll go back. And but if I do that here, if you were within driving distance of this church, I'd be here every time the doors opened, I guarantee you. So that's my commercial. Let's get to the Word of God today, Psalm 23. David would write it, and he says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want."
Yeah.
I could just stop and preach there for an hour. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow. Surely. Surely. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. I want to create confidence and faith in a relationship that those of you that are believers here today, that you might have in the God that has saved you and has committed his person and all that he is to you. I want you to leave here today a little more encouraged. We go through things in this life, and those things that attack us can sometimes effectively steal our faith. Let me preach over here. Those things that we go through can sometimes effectively steal, nullify, rob us of the confidence that we have in Christ. I want to see that restored in your heart and your life today. And if you're here this morning and for whatever reason you have wandered outside of the path, you've wandered away from the fold, or perhaps you've never really truly committed. You came with mom today, and I commend you for doing that. But there's a more important decision that lies in front of you today other than just coming to be with your mother. And that is Jesus your shepherd?
Amen.
Is he the one that has been granted through your faith and your willingness the opportunity to shepherd you? And I want to preach and teach a simple message. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. Is he your shepherd this morning? That's the question. The Lord is my shepherd. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to minister your word this morning. And I thank you for all the attributes of Christ that are available to us today. Father, in the next few minutes, help me to make these truths come alive by the anointing of the Holy Spirit. In and of ourselves, we can do nothing. So let the Holy Spirit come. Let the preacher come. Let the teacher come. The one that makes teaching and preaching easy. And open the hearts and the minds of all that sit before us. And we'll give you the praise for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen,
amen.
And amen. You know, the thought process that the Lord, Jesus Christ, is a shepherd is a motif or a subject that runs throughout Scripture. We can find it all throughout the Scripture. And first of all, I love the idea that in John 10, 11, he says, I am the good shepherd. Why is he the good shepherd? Because he laid down his life for the sheep. If you're a member of his sheepfold today, you didn't earn it, you didn't gain it through good works, you didn't access it by any other means but by faith. And that faith was in the shepherd who 2,000 years ago laid down his life, paid the penalty for your sin and mine, and created access to a God that cannot fail. The God that created all of heaven and all of the earth. He's the good shepherd this morning because he laid down his life in the cross. He laid down his perfect sinless life, and he paid the penalty for your sin and mine. It doesn't matter how much sin we've committed, even though that is hurtful to us. It only matters that 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ paid the entire penalty for every sin that you and I and everyone that has ever breathed would ever commit in an entirety of life. It matters not 2,000 years ago. All we like sheep have gone astray, but the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He paid the penalty. He's the good shepherd. In Hebrews, he's the great shepherd. Listen to this. He's not just the one that laid down his life for the sheep, but he's also the sanctifier of the sheep. He's the great shepherd. In Hebrews 13, 20 and 21, the Bible says, "Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work." Now we know that none of us are perfect. Shout amen if you believe that. But we are being perfected by the processes of faith and grace. If you're a member of the sheepfold, then what God wants to do is transform you from what you are today to what God could make you tomorrow. He doesn't want you to remain the same. We don't stay in our sin. I'm glad that grace covers it all, but that does not give me permission to remain unchanged. I'm here today in this world to be transformed by the power of God's grace, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Can't change myself. Can't change what I need to be myself into what I need to become. I've got to be being changed by the power of faith and grace. Grace is the effectual working of the Holy Spirit that comes to me as a result of faith, and my faith has to rest in the great shepherd, the one who loved me and gave himself for me. It's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. And the life that I now live in this perfecting, this maturing, this transforming, this going on, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. He is the great shepherd today. He's changing me. I'm not the same man that stood here the last time I stood here. I'm being changed by the power of God's grace and by the power of the Holy Spirit through faith. So he's not just a good shepherd, but he's also the great shepherd. And one day, he's going to act as the chief shepherd, according to Peter in 1 Peter chapter 5 and 4. "And when the chief shepherd shall appear, we shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away." There's coming an hour, and there's coming a day, and the signs of the times are all around us. Jesus is going to return. I said, Jesus is going to return. I'm glad, because on that day, all sickness is going to be gone. Death is going to be gone. This transformation process will be over, and I will forever live in the presence of a God who loved me and has given himself for me. He is not just my good shepherd, the shepherd who has, in fact, given his life for me. He's not just the good shepherd. He's also the great shepherd transforming me, and he's the chief shepherd. But here's the most important thing. I want to go back and go away from the good shepherd, great shepherd, and chief shepherd and ask you this question. Is he your shepherd? David said, "The Lord is my." There's where we are, isn't it? That personal pronoun. The Lord is my. Can you say that this morning? The Lord is my. I don't know what you've got, but I know what I've got. The Lord is. Not maybe, not might be, not could be. This morning, the Lord is. He stands sure. He's a firm foundation. He can't fail. He doesn't deny me. He doesn't walk away from me. Even when I fail him, even when I walk away from him, he doesn't walk away from me. The Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And the Lord there means covenant God. It's Jehovah, the Hebrew, the covenant God, which takes us back to covenant and how it was accomplished. We go back to the cross, don't we? Because it's at the cross that covenant was cut so that God could in fact become your shepherd, your caretaker. The Lord this morning, because of Jesus and what he did for me, is He's my. I'm glad he's yours, but he's got to be. If you've got to have this yourself today, he is
mine.
Say it. He is my shepherd. I want you confident in that. The Lord, Jehovah God, covenant God. When you say covenant God, you're going back to the statement that God told Moses, "Tell the people, I am."
Yes.
That I am. See, I'm covenant God. What does that mean?
Yes.
Whatever you have to need of, that's what I am. I said, whatever you have need of, the Lord Jehovah God is mine. I said, he is mine. I said, he is mine. He's Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is here. He's Jehovah Sitkenu, my righteousness. He's Jehovah Mekadishkim. He's the one who sanctifies me. He's Jehovah Rapha. He's the one who heals me. He's Jehovah Jireh. He's the one that provides for me. He's Jehovah Shalom. He's my peace. He's Jehovah Nissi. He's my banner. He's the one who fights for me. Jehovah God is mine. Hallelujah. And based on that fact, the Lord is by faith, through grace, my shepherd. Then I declare to my issue, I declare to my problem, I declare to my lack of finances, I declare to my misery, I declare to my sickness, I shall not want. Why? Because it's all in him. I said it's all in him, and I'm in covenant. I said I'm in covenant. And covenant, you've got to understand this now. Let me slow down and give it to you. Covenant is an agreement between two parties. Normally, there is a lesser and a greater party. And the greater party has conquered the lesser party in some manner or in some way. And they come and they make covenant. And the lesser party says, everything that I am, everything that I have, everything that I own, I willingly surrender to you. But it doesn't stop there, because covenant is two-sided. And God, on the other side of this covenant, the greater, of course, in the covenant that you have, has said to you, everything that I am, everything that I have, everything that I can do, all my power, all my grace, all my authority, I will now relinquish on your behalf. Now we're talking covenant. The Lord is...
Yes.
Covenant God is my shepherd, and based on that truth, I shall not. I wish somebody would have some faith in here this morning. I shall not want. Take that problem to the Lord and tell him, the Lord, Lord, I believe it. You're my shepherd. I didn't earn you. I didn't deserve you. I didn't labor for this. But I'm in covenant with you because I placed my faith in your son and what he did for me at Calvary. I've asked you to forgive me of my sin. I've moved away from my wayward walk. I've gone to that place where I've surrendered my life to you. And I've given you my heart and I've given you my life. And therefore I can, like David, say, the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. The bills won't overwhelm me. The sickness won't destroy me. The things I'm struggling through right now, they're going to be conquered by the power of faith and grace. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I found myself walking in prayer and facing some enemies and facing some trials, as we all do. This Christian experience is not just a situation where every day we just shoot from victory to victory to victory and we're never opposed and we never have problems and we never have doubts and we never have fears.
Right.
Amen.
If that's you, you're superhuman, or there's not two brain cells bumping together up there. Because in this life, Jesus said, you shall have tribulation. So I'm sorry, my word of faith friends, you're not going to just speak the word and all your trials are gone. You're going to face trials, but how you face them makes a whole lot of difference. How you face them and travel through them determine whether your faith will grow through the trial or it will diminish. You going through something today need to say, the Lord is my shepherd, my covenant shepherd, and I shall not want. Verse 2. I love this. He maketh me to lie down. You know, one of the first things that God is going to have to get you to do is lie down.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's right.
Cease from your own strength and abilities.
Right.
He makes me give up faith in what I can do. He makes me.
Yes.
He doesn't allow me to enter into the solution business.
Amen.
And rest is the first benefit that you have of having a relationship with Christ. Rest. In the Old Covenant, the Sabbath was a principle that was initiated under the law. We don't keep it day to day, but that principle brought into God's moral thinking might be the most important principle of your Christian experience. Do you rest because the Lord is your shepherd? Do you know that as a sheep, and I'm not talking down to you because I are one, we're dumb. Do you realize we can't find our way home? You can turn us loose, but we can't find food. We can't find shelter. Sheep, by their very, I mean, goats can do that. Other animals can do that. But sheep are totally hopeless and helpless. And you and I have to come to the place where we decide, I can't shepherd myself.
Amen.
I'm not the Lord of my life. I don't do a good job at it.
Amen.
Whenever you take over, ladies and gentlemen, I dare say life doesn't turn out the way that it might. You might have encountered a few surprises if you tried to shepherd yourself. My daughter Rachel preached a message a few days ago in the Bible college and talked to us about the Lord is a door. And I loved it. I said it on the program last week. I didn't tell them it was Rachel right off, and we had all the preachers talking about it. But the Lord is the door. There's only one way into the sheepfold, and everybody else trying to get the care and all the things that are inside the sheepfold that don't go through the door, Christ, are thieves and robbers.
Yes, yes.
They're trying to climb the wall to get into the sheepfold to get all the benefits. And there's the door.
Yeah, come on. Come on.
There's the door. You don't have to, wait, in our churches we have rope climbing ministries and ladder building ministries all to get over the wall. We get, double exercises so we can leap over the wall. All these different ways to leap over the wall. And God says, there's the door. There's the door. There's the door. You want the benefits of being a sheep? Walk through the door.
Come on.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. Walk through the door. And he didn't just say that to get you saved, even though he said that to get you saved. He said, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. But after you're saved, you've got to depend upon your shepherd to go in and to go out to find pasture. And the first thing your shepherd is going to do is say, put down your rope climbing ministry, get rid of your ladders and your scaffolds, quit trying to go over the wall someplace else. There's a door, and he's going to make you lie.
Hallelujah.
Right now.
Yes.
Rest. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures, soft grass, good food, spiritually and physically. I could stay there a while. He'll place you at rest. That's why I say the church you attend is so vital. It's so important. The Lord will lead you to the place that you're supposed to be. He'll guide you by his Spirit. Don't say, oh, I don't need to be there. I don't need to participate in that. He's guiding you. He's leading you. And when you find that place of green pasture, feeding, and security, stay there. Lie down. It doesn't mean that you're inert. It doesn't mean that you won't participate in ministry. It doesn't mean that you're not going to be active. It doesn't mean that you're going to be active. In fact, people that know how to lie down and rest in the Lord are the busiest people in the kingdom and the most effective because they're resting in Christ.
Amen.
They know they are complete in him.
Yes. Right.
And they follow him. He leads them beside the still waters. Not a raging torrent that you can't drink from, not muddied, still ponds of swamp, but a slow-moving, clear, clean stream. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters, where I can as a sheep walk to the bank and put my nose in and drink to the fill. The still waters where I can be cleansed and cleaned of the mud and the dirt and the filth. I can get into the water and be cleansed in the presence of the Lord. Can you get, it's still water, a type of the Holy Spirit, still water, living in you, able to drink, able to cleanse, able to move. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He puts me in the right place. He leads me beside the still waters. He places me where the Holy Spirit can fill me, initiate me, move through me. And in the middle of my life, you know, life attacks you emotionally, and your mind and your heart get broken. He even restores my soul. The soul is the part of you that feels. It's the part of man that has emotion. It's the part of man that knows. And he knows that we get bruised along life's way. He knows we get angry. We get confused. Anybody else human in here? I get angry. I get confused. I think, what are they saying? What are they doing? Do they know what? 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 No, this can't be. That's not right. That's can't. Anybody ever get confused, discouraged, ever get dismayed? Well, the Bible says, hey, don't be discouraged, don't be dismayed. Fear not. Why? Because we get discouraged, we get dismayed, and we're full of fear. Am I the only fool in the sheepfold? It happens to me, but you know, just when I need it. He knows how to pull me aside and restore my broken heart and mind. I know everybody's a little bit different. I have, I'll be honest, I have the music ministry of my kids. I like it. When I can't get the moving of the Holy Spirit in my own heart, my own life, I go to YouTube and plug in Joseph Larson, Healing Waters. Rachel Larson, I Will Rise. Grace Larson, listen to my heart. And I just cry a little while as the presence of God sweeps over my soul. Maybe it's in a service, maybe like this, maybe it's in a church, maybe it's on SBN programming, maybe it's in a classroom. I don't know, but what I do know is when I'm broken down to what I think is past my ability to rise up from the debris, God, my shepherd, steps in and he restores my soul. Grace always liked to say it to me, Dad, just breathe, just breathe. Well, now that she's got little Wyatt and goes crazy, I say, Grace, just breathe. He restoreth my soul. What a good God. He leadeth me beside still waters. He makes me lie down in the gentle green grass. He restores my soul. He is my shepherd. I shall not want. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness. Righteousness is not an option. Holiness is not an option in the church.
That's right.
It's not an option. You can't decide to live unholy. Your shepherd won't allow that. Now, he'll let you make the choice, but you'll also hurt your relationship with the shepherd. And he's a good shepherd. He'll follow you down that path that you took that he didn't want you to go down. And he'll locate you on the cliff of life where you've abandoned yourself, trapped yourself. And he'll pull you up time and time again. And he'll bring you back time and time again. And if you don't heed his warnings and you continue to go off the path and out of the sheepfold, one time he'll pick you up after he rescues you from your dilemma, and he'll break your leg. And then he'll set it, and he'll put you on his shoulder.
Amen.
It's called the chastising of the Lord. It's not fun, but every now and then it's necessary. I wish I could learn just by the Word and by the Spirit. But every now and then there's things I can't learn unless he takes me to the woodshed. And he spiritually breaks me. Last year I went through a situation with my heart, about 18 months of really scary stuff. Didn't know what was happening. The Lord used it to break me. Lord, isn't there another way? Couldn't we do this? Wouldn't it be easier another way? Finally had an ablation in January, and praise the Lord, the problems have resolved. But those 18 months were hard. They were difficult. They were scary. And I learned how to rely on him. When you think you could die, you pray more. Come on, somebody, help me here. When you're not sure what's going on with you, and look, you know that you're the most important thing in your world. It's all about you. It's me. Me, 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 me. Not you. Not her. Not them. Not it. It's me. And when me gets messed with, we search a little bit more. And he takes us through things we wouldn't normally go through. We're like water. We find the way of least resistance in life. And Lord, take me there. Bless me, but don't break me. And he brings us through. Honestly, there's really one major reason for it. And that is the process of dependence and faith grows if we travel through it correctly. And you'll get a little closer to the Lord, and some of the things that you were doing and thinking and associated with will fall off, not because you have a rule book, not because you have 1,000 things that God says you're bad and you got to change, but because you just got closer to him as you travel through it. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. When I live right, it brings glory to his name. When I live wrong, there's sorrow, and even a disparity to his name. I don't want my life to belittle the Savior's name. And he works overtime to make sure that I don't. He imputes righteousness to me. He builds righteousness in me. I don't always like the way he does it, but that's why I'm the sheep and he's the shepherd, and I recognize I can't shepherd myself. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Let's go to verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Again, as I've shared, I won't go back through it, but you'll go through difficult times. I want you to note the terminology. Yea, though I walk. Get that word walk right? Though I walk, you're not staying. You're not staying, you're just walking through the valley. You're not going to stay there forever. It didn't come to stay, it came to pass. You're walking through the valley. And if you'll remind yourself, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not walk. The walk through will be a little easier. anybody walking through the valley today. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. I'm almost done, and that means nothing, but I'm almost done. Thy rod and thy staff. The rod is a protective element. It used as a club to protect the sheep from the enemy that comes. And the staff, it guides and draws the sheep back. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Anybody ever been protected by the Lord? Anybody ever been guided by the Lord? As you walk through the valley, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my hurting soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Verse 5. Oh, I love this. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Covenant relationship says that when you sit down in covenant with someone, they protect you from everything and everyone that would try to destroy you. It's exampled probably in a negative sense, but yet you can see it in the situation with Lot and Sodom and Gomorrah. Remember Lot? And the two angels that God sent traveled into the Sodom and Gomorrah area. Lot sees them, and he knows they're going to be in trouble because he knows the people of Sodom and Gomorrah, and he knows that the men there are going to try to abuse them sexually or hurt them in some manner. And so he says, come home with me. And the angels travel home with him, and Lot brings him into his house, and he closes the door. You've read the story. And almost immediately, the wicked men of Sodom and Gomorrah come and knock on the door. And they say, send these men out. We want to, quote, quote, know them. I'm not going to go into details. You can figure this out. We want to know them. And Lot says, no, I can't do that. They have come under the shadow of my roof. Covenant talk. So while all the men outside are yearning for and longing for hurt and abuse to come to these men, Lot is saying, you can't touch them. They're under the shadow. I will give you my daughters. If you think me, I'm going to say that, you're waiting a long time. I'm not that much into covenant when it comes to my daughter. No. But Lot said, I'll even give you my daughter. You see the power of covenant? They've come under the shadow of my roof, and I must protect them at all costs. Here's my wife, here's my daughters, I'll send them out. But no. See, when you're in covenant relationship, God looks at your enemy that's right outside your door and says, you can't.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
They're under.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. They're under the shadow. He that dwelleth under the shadow of the Almighty. Covenant talk. Your God. While all of the world around you is raging for your destruction, sickness trying to tear you down, all the hurt and the pain of life traveling against you, God says to those that are coming against you, you can't touch them. And by the way, don't bother us, I'm serving dinner. Right in the midst of all of the enemies and the surrounding and the opposition, that's right, God sets a table for you and says, don't worry about them. I got this. Let's just sit down and have a feast. And listen, when God sets a table for you, I said, when God sets a table for you, when God sets a table for you, you're going to like what you get. It'll be all of your favorites. Mama couldn't cook so good. Sorry, Mama, Mom's Day. Mama couldn't cook so good. God sets a table for you, gives you just what you need in the middle of this that's going on in your life, and the enemies are sitting there staring, and God says, you just shut up and just leave them alone until they get done eating. And even then, I'm going to limit what you can do. He sets a table. The Lord is mine. I shall not want. He prepares a table for me in the midst of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. The shepherd would oftentimes rub the oil into the nose of the sheep that was... sheep are always sticking their nose where they don't belong. They get scratches and hurts and pain. And I'm told that the odor of the ointment even would move serpents away. Because of the smell, when they would stick their nose down a hole in the pasture that was an adder or a snake's hole, and they would smell that oil, and the snake would go the other way. Let me tell you, God will anoint you with the power of the Holy Spirit. Satan won't want any part of you. The Lord is mine. So, he anoints my head with oil. My cup runneth over. You've been sentenced to blessing. As a sheep of the shepherd, you've been sentenced to blessing. The blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and he addeth no sorrow with it. That doesn't mean you're going to be a millionaire, but it means that God's blessings can abide on you and will make you rich in your life in the things that matter. My cup runneth over. And then he goes to the future, surely. Goodness. Goodness. The good things of God. Freely given because of what Christ did for you at Calvary. The goodness of God. That blessing you didn't ask for, think you'd ever get, or know you didn't deserve it. He just gives it to you. Goodness and mercy. In the Hebrew, it's hasid. You know what hasid is? It's covenant all over again. It's God's word for covenant. Surely, goodness and mercy. When you don't deserve it, he's still there to say, I forgive. When you don't deserve it, he's still there to say, I'll work for you. You've got two stalkers. Goodness and mercy. Everywhere you go, they're following. What's that behind you, brother? Oh, that's Miss Goodness. What's on that side? Oh, that's Miss Mercy. If you want Mr. and Mr., that's fine with me. Goodness and mercy shall follow me on occasion.
No.
Goodness and the covenant love of God will follow me all the days of my life. And when this life is over, it's still not over. I will dwell in the presence of God forever and ever and ever. The Lord is my shepherd. Shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my hurting soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. His rod and his staff, they comfort. Lord prepares a table for me in the presence of mine enemies. He's anointing my head with oil. My cup runneth over. And surely, without fail, positively, goodness and mercy are on my heels. They're following me no matter where I go, whatever I do. And I am assured that in the future, when this life is over, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So I ask you this morning, is he your shepherd? Are you telling him? I did. He won't fail you. When you deserve it the least, he'll show up and give you the most.
Amen.
He won't fail you. Isn't it time to say, God, I'm coming home. I'm going to go through the door, Christ Jesus. I'm going to go into the sheepfold of the Master. I'm going to go in and out, and I'm going to make him my shepherd. He's ready for you. He's had you in mind for a long time. And if you're away from that sheepfold today, or if you've never made him your shepherd, or if you need him in some of the aspects to come alive and active today, then you're in the right place this morning, because the Lord wants to be your shepherd so that you should not want. Would you stand with me this morning? Singers, musicians, if you come. I won't draw it out. I'll turn it over to Francis, but yet I want to say it. And I want to say it very vehemently, very carefully. I'm going to simply ask, and I know you've done this 1,000 times, every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around. If you're here this morning and you say, Brother Larson, I'm not a member of the sheepfold, but I'm ready. I'm ready to give my life to Jesus, and I'm ready to accept him as my Savior. I won't wait forever. But if you know that, the Lord's been dealing with you. He's been convicting you that you're not where you need to be. Would you just raise that hand up and say, pray for me. I see that hand. Is there another? Pray for me. Pray. I see those hands. I see them. Pray for me. Pray for me. I'm a member of a sheepfold, but I haven't been trusting him like I need to. Pray for me, Brother Larson. Would you pray for me? I say, I'm going through something this morning. I need him as my shepherd. I need him as my shepherd. I need him. Father, in the name of Jesus, let everyone whose heart smote them today, everyone who has felt the drawing of the Holy Spirit, right now let them come to the great shepherd, the good shepherd, the chief shepherd. Let them know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you want to be their shepherd today. To guide them, to lead them, to instruct them, to change them, to bless them, to keep them for all eternity. Father, in the name of Jesus, do what only you can do. Save that soul. Move in that heart. Change their lives forever. He was there all the time. Oh, he was there. Just waiting patiently.